In response to pressure from students, parents, and teachers, the Great Neck School Board in 1970 established an experimental alternative school, which in 1972 has 64 students who have been selected randomly from over 300 applicants. It has 4 full-time teachers who have been chosen by the students and approved by the district administration. It has the complete financial support of the Great Neck Public Schools and is centered in a separate district-owned facility, and controversially, offers no restrictions on time, space, attendance, curriculum, or activity.
It would not have been possible, and I think this is a very important thing for people who are contemplating similar ventures elsewhere to understand. Pardon me, it would not have been possible for us to submit to the State Department a detailed plan in advance of the program that would have answered all of the questions that every member of the State Education Department or anybody else for that matter might have raised. We simply couldn't have done that. Because the essence of the program was that it be, or a large part of its essence was, that it be genuinely created by the participants. So you can't have some planning committee sit down over here and spell the whole thing out down to the last jot and tittle, and then they invite the participants in to do that same thing. You'd have the same thing you had all over again. It would not be their creation.
The Village School is a school without a philosophy. At the very beginning, it was never defined, nor has it been defined since. And that is our biggest single weakness. It may also be our only real strength. But maybe the business of the Village School is agonizing. Maybe the real business of the Village School is asking, what am I doing, why am I doing it, and what should I be doing?
We do not see the Village School as a cure for senioritis, or as a terminal high school activity in preparation for assuming the responsibilities of college. Nor are we merely a refuge for would-be dropouts or malcontents, which is not to say that there is not a valid place in our system for meeting all of these needs. It is only to say that we who have been involved view our experiment otherwise. Our objective is to see whether some young people would be better served by our educational system in a freer, ungraded situation in which the student, to a great extent, creates his own options and is not locked into channels laid out by either educational authority or societal pressures.
Can the student, by participating in this relatively unstructured environment, prepare himself to cope with a more structured environment? And my answer to that question is emphatically yes, because it is, after all, the student who has to do the organizing of his own time and his own activity, so that when he gets into a situation where there are greater strictures on him, he may chafe at those strictures and may ultimately decide that they're not fruitful for him and rebel. But there'll be no question that he can operate within it. The danger, and we have abundant evidence of this, is the other way around, and that is when a student who has been operating in a structured environment suddenly finds himself in a free environment, then there has been no preparation in his own life for coping.
I really don't know what I want to do with myself, and I see no reason why I shouldn't go to college.
Wait a second.
Major battle I have as a teacher, anyway, is to fight the 15 years of doing things one way, where I dictate how things go, and try instead to be involved in facilitating how things go rather than creating it. Of course, part of the question is I haven't answered completely. Is how much my role is one of being there to support and facilitate, and how much that's being unfair to myself too, and you know, I have surely the freedom to initiate and create things too.
Well, I think one of the biggest things in letting go is, if for instance you find your son or your daughter in bed at 11 o'clock in the morning on a day that's supposed to be a school day, that you don't flip, because believe it or not, these kids are accomplishing something and doing something. So their time schedule may not be the exact 8 to 3 or 2:30, that you are used to. Now, this is the second year for me, so that I can say, smilingly, that it really does work out and work out fantastically. But getting off the kids' backs is a big step in the right direction. That I had committed myself to in terms of, like classes or seminars in school and outside things that I had done for myself because of those responsibilities. But I don't feel guilty about it but I have evaluated and come to the conclusion that I really don't have to feel guilty because the things that I got are different, but probably more essential at this point in my life because there are basics on which I can build new things.
I really do not believe that people can do nothing for any great length of time. You get bored. Just as you were bored with classes, you get bored with nothing. And I know that just coming here, if I don't start doing something, if I come here for a day and I sit around, there's just so much you can talk about, and then you feel like you want to start something.
I knew when I was doing nothing, and then I began to do something, because it was my own guilt that said, you're doing shit, you want to study something. Go out and do it, and I did it.
Well, I haven't gotten into anything really, but I believe that when I feel that I want to get into something, that I feel good about the school because I feel that I have someone to go to in the school, a teacher or a student.
I wouldn't even want to call those, say, 3 months or whatever time each individual student went through floundering wasted time at all, because it, in a sense, is learning the process of learning rather than the actual content of it.
We decided very early in the year that it was impossible for us to say what was educationally valuable and what was not. So I think our attitude is basically that you try and get somebody involved in something, and if you can't, and that what they want to do is sit home and play vegetable, that's their right.
I'm kind of happy now in the village school just because I've gotten into an attitude about it that things are just going to kind of come as they will. And if at this point I'm really not horribly motivated, it's really okay. But I think that one mistake that we really have made, one very bad mistake, is hiding behind our classes and really being afraid to flounder in this whole business. Really almost a very defensive type of a structure where if someone wasn't doing anything, like you said, that was far out or something like that, they could just go to a couple of classes and say, yeah, I'm doing something in the village school. Like if you're just there taking those classes, maybe there are minor variations on classes in the high school. If you're there just there taking those classes, then you might as well be in the high school.
I got a lot accomplished last year as far as music goes. More than I've ever accomplished in any other thing previous to that.
I hate to say this about it because it may turn out in a week that I'm all wrong, but at this stage anyway, this is what's happening. One is that we decided that meeting the way we did just didn't work. Too many gaps in between. So we said we're going to meet every day for a period of time, set ourselves some sort of a goal and try and accomplish it. The input of the kid has been fantastic. And so has mine. I've been working my ass off on it too, but I would say from what the kids said, they're spending minimum 45 minutes and sometimes as much as 2.5 hours a night on this, in addition to the from minimum of 45 to 2.5 hours that I spend with them plus whatever I do. And we're going to do this until next Tuesday, which means we've done it for about 6 school days. Then they're going to give them a test on Wednesday. We're going to go over the test on Thursday, and then we're going to stop. And then we'll talk about whether they want to go on individually or we'll just all take a break and come back in a couple of weeks. Now, what has happened then is my role has somewhat changed with regard to them, but so has their role with regard to me and to themselves. I've become more demanding of them, though they have the right at any moment to just leave.
I think I was still so overwhelmed with the thought of all that freedom and actually doing what I wanted to do for the first time. Of course, you know, that's changed a bit now because you begin to realize what it means to do what you want to do. You've got to know what you want to do.
While calling up different universities to find out if I could take courses, I came in touch with the assistant dean of faculty, mathematics and natural sciences division. And he was very helpful in giving me people's names to pursue and talk to.
The American Museum of Natural History, I'm working on a paper on the schizochoral eye of the trilobite Phacops rana variation milleri with the assistant curator of invertebrate paleontology and using a computer and taking data on these extinct animals and meeting people at the museum and also Queens College taking a course in paleontology and courses in archaeology.
First, I just worked with small groups of kids and reading and math skills. And then after a while, I did my own science lessons with the whole class. And I really found that education was a great thing for me.
Do you feel that working in a hardware store is educationally sound?
No, it's not actually sound in the sense that I'm not getting anything out of it now. I'm going to make a hell of a lot of money, and with the money that I'm making here, I'm going down to Latin America. So in that sense, you can say it is sound, because with the $600-odd I'm going to make, I'm going to travel down to Mexico, I'm going to learn Spanish, I'm going to meet new people, and I'm going to have a great summer. Esta es la. Before working at Nassau McGowan, I did an incredible amount of individual reading. That's one of the primary reasons why I had to go down to Latin America to meet new people. I spent 6 months in virtual solitary confinement studying economics.
The reason that I started to go to Senior Citizens was because I really wanted to talk to that age group of people, you know, the people who weren't my parents' age, but who were older. You know, I went there with an attitude that there wasn't going to be that much, but it really turned out to be one of the most beautiful experiences in my life because they really were interested in us as people.
But at this point, don't you take that as guidance, and guidance is what one needs
you have to learn and throughout life to self-discipline yourself. That's the most important thing, not to have somebody else discipline you, not to have somebody teach you and tell you that's naughty.
So I went to Clover Drive School, which is an elementary school in Britain, to work with kids. They were 6 years old to 9 years old who were slow learners. And I did that twice a week, every day, and I really got a lot out of that. And then after that, I decided that I wanted to go back for another summer in a different camp, but also for handicapped children. After my summer experience, I decided that I wanted to still pursue or further pursue my interest in special education. And I got a job in the city at Gateway. And because I was in a village school, I didn't have to be there any certain day.
Such a long time ago, I was walking on a lonely road, getting tired of dreaming alone, like all the lonely people I had known. Seems like such a long time ago, there was no one who would share my song. I was just a boy far from home. Became a man when you came along.
Kids and teachers take their responsibility to one another more seriously in this school than any of the conventional schools that I have seen. You know, usually in the traditional school, the kid goes in and all he really has to do is keep his nose clean and look out for number one. I mean, it's his grades that he has to worry about and getting his homework in on time and keeping his name clean and all the rest of that. The people in the village school have deliberately tried to cultivate a more mutual responsibility than that, so that when one kid begins to slide, perhaps more than he should, others begin to exert some kind of subtle pressure on him to sort of jog him out of that.
I would say, I don't know, if a group has to do something together, if it's a common activity,
and the people in the group get more together.
I think that in the truest sense of the word, in the profoundest sense of the word, students at the Village School and faculty at the Village School feel for one another. And it's a feeling for one another that transcends the normal or usual or traditional peer relationship that one would find in a regular high school. And I suspect that one of the things that happened at the Village School this year and the previous year is as each individual attempted to grow, attempted to become his own human being, and attempted to understand his own nature and his own emotions and his own needs and his own concerns, that he became aware of other people's needs and concerns and worries.
They should donate some of their time and give up some of their individual pleasures to doing things which would be pleasurable for everybody.
The only way a community can really be gotten is for individuals to be able to cope with it, that they can think more beyond just themselves and start thinking a little bit about other people.
I think they're into their own thing, and the school provides a way for them to get into their own thing. But I think we can only have a sense of community if everybody is working consciously for the same purpose. I don't think we're doing that. And I think it's perhaps too much to expect that we could be doing that.
As far as evaluation is concerned, that's a very difficult question to answer, because if you're looking for numbers or tests, that's not the way one evaluates such a school. Now, what might be some of the ways in which we would evaluate it? Well, first of all, were the graduates of this school successful in getting into colleges? And we made no such promise when the Village School was organized. That's one evaluation. Other evaluations, and these are not quantified, what have been the reactions of the students who went to that school about what their experience has been?
It seems to me that the parents who volunteered last year and those who will volunteer this year, and if we continue the program and will volunteer in the pursuing years, are well enough informed, I think. They were well aware that this program would not specifically cover every academic area in full. And I guess parents who are afraid and who fear that some children may lose out in certain particular areas, which they may never use in their lives, those parents will not volunteer their children, or the children won't volunteer. So I don't think we have to worry about that. I hope we don't start using criteria which kill the concept.
Do you see any danger for the school in the future?
The danger, it seems to me, comes from without, and it will be whether the more conservative portion of the community will continue to tolerate you, or whether they won't. And I just can't make a prediction about that right now. Incidentally, I also see some danger from the conservative portion of the faculty, because from their point of view, of course, academic standards have been scattered to the winds, and the authority of the school has been jeopardized, and perhaps their own role as teachers and administrators has been cast in shadow, and they are a source of threat also. See, in the ultimate philosophic sense, my answer would be that the school is for everyone. My worldview, if you will, and my understanding of what life and education are about would suggest that this is the kind of experience which is of enormous profit to any participant. Now, as a practical matter, talking within the realm of American public schooling, the answer would be absolutely not. The school is not for everyone. Kids come out of different family circumstances. Parents have different attitudes. They've been conditioned to accept or to reject certain modes of operation, and for that reason, you don't want to cram upon other people your own worldview.
I do feel, and I have been accepted as a person in the school, and I don't think I really have problems with that role. I do have a hell of a lot of hang-ups still. What's your profession? I'm part of what I think and what I hope is sort of a dying profession. That is, professional social studies teachers. I'm hoping that society will move in the direction where all people, but particularly adults who assume responsibility earlier than young people, take on the responsibility of helping the youth to become citizens.
If I could change one thing, it might be my performance in the school and how, you know, the slowness of how I adapted to the school.
I think that I would like to see people more tolerant of each other.
What's the greatest asset of the Village School?
The ability for me to do what I'm interested in and the way I'd like to do it and ask my questions and get answers that I believe in instead of having people ask questions for me and give them the answers that they believe in.
The greatest asset is that it can become anything that the students want it to be, so that it never has to become one thing, so that you can always change it and it can always be flexible.
And, you know, it's a very human situation where people have a chance to grow.
I think the greatest asset of the school is that people have learned to teach themselves how to learn.
The school is so much becomes what you want it to be, in that, you know, there's 64 people and there's 64 different schools, and because nothing's imposed and there's hardly any structure, you know, the school is what you totally make it.
I've had the most difficult year of my life. I've changed, I think, more this year than in any 5-year period, 10-year period. I've had to reconsider things that I took for granted. I even have to justify to myself and to other people things that no English teacher on earth should have to justify, the importance of reading and writing, to myself as well. So it's been a long and very successful year, I think.
Since I'm here, I have grown and I've changed and I've learned and I've experienced. And when you're doing all these things, that's very, very positive. And yes, of course I would do it again. Might not have happened somewhere else.
If you had it to do again, would you go into the school?
Definitely.
Definitely. Definitely, without any question.
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind that I would definitely do it again.
I would positively be in a Village School again. These clouds stick to the sky like a floating question mark. They linger there to die. They don't know where they're going, and my friend, neither do I.